seems that the risk of war in the OSCE area is now greater than ever before in the last 30 years. In this vein, we should focus on a peaceful resolution of the conflict in and around Ukraine in compliance with the Minsk agreements and in full respect of the sovereignty, territorial integrity and unity of Ukraine within its internationally recognized borders.
Shalom, Kahala Yahweh Bashem Yahushai, Bashem Rukokadash. Double honors my teachers, the apostles and elders of Great Millstone. Peace and mercy to the elect who the house of David be born again in this generation. And shalom to the 130 Yasha Rala, who today we're known as the Negroes, Latinos, and Native Americans. But before losing our true heritage, we were known as, and still are, the true Hebrew Israelites of the Holy Bible. In today's lesson, we're going to talk about some of the recent developments on the path for World War III. But before we get into that, let's read this scripture. This is Revelations 11 and 14. The second woe is past, and behold, the third woe cometh quickly. Now, John the Revelator, in his vision that he was given, he was shown the three world wars, right? And he refers to them as woes. Now, at this point, he had just finished watching the Second World War, right? And when you get into this chapter, John explains the images that he's seen, and he explains events and people, you know, their characteristics, what they look like from World War II. Well, he goes on and he explains that in his vision, he sees that the third world war that's to break out upon the earth, which is going to be the final and great war upon the earth, which the Bible refers to as Armageddon. He says that it is going to come up upon the earth very quickly. Now, in the video you just saw, the Polish foreign minister says, he says, Europe is closer to war now than at any point in the last 30 years, right? And it says, Poland's foreign minister has warned that Europe is closer to war than it has been at any time in the last three decades. At the launch of his country's year-long chairing of the region's largest security organization, without naming Russia in his address, on Thursday, which basically is the day we just came out of, by the time you're watching this, it's going to be Friday. On Thursday, to envoys from the 57 members of the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, Zbigniew Rey mentioned tensions in Ukraine, Georgia, Armenia, Moldova, all countries with active or frozen conflicts in which Russia has been allegedly to be a party. So you see, what's happening is that Russia is getting roused up. See, the Lord, as it tells us in the scripture, that the Lord would put hooks in their jaws and bring them back to war. That's what's happening with Russia, right? See, they've been, when you understand the American military policy, it's to be fully dominant in all avenues of life, right? The sea, the land, the air, cyberspace, and so forth. Well, Russia has almost the same, you know, mentality. They're a lot more secretive in their movements, and just because we're here in America, we don't hear a lot of the things going on, right? The propaganda that gets pushed onto the American people is also includes not letting us know what these other nations are doing against America, right? But little by little, we're starting to see more tensions build up against America, which is biblically known as Babylon the Great. Namely, its main rival, Russia, starting to now become more aggressive in its actions, right? Before, Russia used to simply just tolerate America, right? Bide its time, help the Russian allies, which for the most part were considered American adversaries, Iran, North Korea, countries of that nature. Well, with all the back and forth between Russia and America basically involving itself in the Georgia region, which is right there by the Caucasus Mountains, mostly due to energy and, you know, oil pipelines going through that area. Russia is, you can obviously tell Russia is now fed up, right? They're now taking a stronger approach. Putin has mentioned in talks that, you know, they have nowhere else to fall back to, that basically with the Ukraine crisis, that's right on their border, right? And when you look at the map, Ukraine is the is right next to Russia, right? So that's why Russia has stepped up and basically protected that area, because if that was to fall, then the American allies would be at Russia's borders, right? It's a similar reason why China has propped up North Korea, because if North Korea was to fall to South Korea, South Korea being an American ally, that would basically put America at China's footsteps in North Korea, right? And China does not want that. So you see, you could see both these adversaries of America, right, or allies, adversaries, they both have taken a buffeted approach to dealing with America, basically putting up a barrier between their country and the outside world, which America, for the most part, controls, right? Because again, this world is the empire of the Edomite. And though Russia aren't a nation of Edomites themselves, they're not the top dog of the nation of Edom, right? That itself would be the Israelis, but the Israelis themselves use America, the American Edomites, as their whipping stick, okay? Now, let's go ahead and see what some of the things that have been happening just here on Thursday. And you got to understand, on Thursday, what happened is that was the final NATO-Russia talks that took place. There was three talks that were supposed to take place this week, Monday, Wednesday, and I think Thursday. And basically all three talks came to nothing. It all basically just kind of fell apart. So for the most part, there's going to be no peace treaty between Russia or America. We're closer to World War III, and we're marching quickly towards it, right? And the reason is because this is all biblical. This is what the Lord wants. So it doesn't matter what these politicians are trying to do, trying to control the flames that are rising up. It's not going to help, right? Because what's going to happen is that the Lord is going to just, you know, pop up new fires in new places, and ultimately it's just going to rouse up these countries. Well, let's read this article and just kind of, you know, get a good idea of what's happening. This article says, Moscow blasts Senate bill to sanction Putin as crossing the line amid unsuccessful NATO talks. After 2 days of Russian NATO talks, the first on Monday in Geneva and the latest Wednesday in Brussels, and with the third being held Thursday in Vienna, and that already happened, at the Organization for Security Cooperation in Europe, there's a consensus that no progress has been made, particularly after the US and NATO rejected as a non-starter Russia's central demand that the Western military bloc halt its eastward expansion, right? And that basically means that, Russia wants America and the UN to stop trying to make all these countries part of NATO, part of the UN, right? Because it doesn't want what Russia sees as neutral parties, neutral countries, joining their adversaries, right? And that's ultimately what's happening. I think, what was it? It was Finland and Sweden today just joined the EU today or something like that, or like they did it like super fast. So you see right now what's happening is that everybody's choosing a side, right? And one of the demands is that Russia put on America and NATO so that way they could stop their aggression is that Russia and NATO, or sorry, America and NATO had to stop trying to bring people over to their side, right? Namely, having them become part of NATO, which biblically NATO is the beast spoken about in Revelations, right? Which the whore rides upon, the whore being America, right? Well, you can see, like from like I just read, these talks went nowhere, right? And these demands were not met. So let's continue and see what happens. It says, however, NATO Secretary General Jan Stoltenberg strongly suggests that both sides remain open to further talks and keeping communications frank and open appearing to be the minimal baseline priority at this point. Russia, through Kremlin spokesman Dmitry Peskov, has bluntly described the talks as unsuccessful, as quoted by Bloomberg. So you see that? So the Lord is putting it into these Edomites' hearts, man, to not be cooperative, man. You can see, like they're saying, man, that they want to, at the minimal base, to just be able to talk, right? That's what they're saying. That this is what we should aim for, is to keep up open an avenue of dialogue, right? But what do they say? It's unsuccessful so far. Well, it says, but Deputy Foreign Minister Alexander Groshko, who led the Russian delegation for the Brussels talk, appeared to agree that dialogue itself was beneficial in order to air Russia's position with no ambiguity, right? Basically, Russia now came out saying, you know, that it's pissed. It's pissed that America is expanding itself into the Eastern Europe closer to Russia, right? It says, I think that this meeting was absolutely essential. Firstly, it was some sort of a shakeup. If the meeting had not taken place, it would have been impossible to bring up these issues in full action, Grusko said, according to the TASS. Bloomberg notes that Moscow is expecting a written answer from the US NATO side, right? That's the whore and the beast. In coming days, regarding the security guarantees, to review Russia's formal request as formed around these three core issues. And this is what Russia's asking for. In a broad outline, Russia's stance boils down to three key points. The pullout of U.S. nuclear weapons from Europe, which is not going to happen. The termination of the practice of deploying NATO's controversial forces near Russia's borders, which may happen, but I doubt it, because these devils don't like backing down, man. They have some major pride on them. It says, and creating its military infrastructure there, and NATO's official refusal to draw Ukraine and Georgia into the alliance, right? So those are the three things that Russia wants, but it's not gonna happen, right? This is Ezekiel 38 and 10. Thus saith Yahweh Bashim Ashai, power, it shall come to pass that at the same time shall things come into thy mind, and thou shalt think an evil thought. And this is ultimately talking about Russia, right? And the adversaries to America, Babylon the Great. You see, the Lord is going to put it into the minds of these I don't want to call them Axis powers, but basically the adversaries to America, Russia, Iran, China, right? And he's gonna start making them see that it's not worth trying to deal, nice with America, right? It's gonna basically backfire on them. So what are they gonna start thinking, right? It says, and thou shalt say, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. I will go to them that are at rest, that dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls. and have neither bars nor gates, to take a spoil and to take prey, to turn thine hand upon the desolate places that are now inhabited, and upon the people that are gathered out of the nations, which have gotten cattle and goods that dwell in the midst of the land. You see that? So this is talking about invasion of America. You see, so the Lord is going to put it into the mind of the adversaries of Babylon the Great to basically betray Babylon the Great and to invade her. And what did we hear today amidst these failed talks? Russia may deploy troops to Venezuela, Cuba, if tensions with U.S. continue to rise. So you see that? What did the scriptures just talk about? That the Lord was going to put it into the heart of the American adversaries to invade America for the first time, right? And we just read in that article that these talks that America and Russia and NATO were having basically failed, right? It's Friday now, and we understand that the talks on Thursday failed in Vienna, right? So what's going to more likely happen is that tensions with the U.S. are going to continue to rise. So pretty much, just like back in the 60s where you had the Russians deploy nuclear missiles to Cuba, and you had that Cuba missile crisis that JFK had to go through and America was going through, and it was on the brink of nuclear annihilation. Well, we're going to go through something similar, right? We've already seen Russia fly their nuclear bombers into Venezuela, right? Remember a few months back, they had flown in like those three large long-range bombers that are capable of carrying nuclear missiles. Well, they're just like America is deploying forces, you know, close to Russia. Well, Russia is going to start doing the same. Let's read this article. It says, amid stalled talks between Russia and NATO over what is effectively a novel split of Europe into geopolitical spheres of influence, Russia has decided to take the show on the road and demonstrate to the U.S. what it feels like to be surrounded by military bases along your borders. And on Thursday, after saying talks with the U.S. over the security situation in Ukraine have stalled, Russia's deputy foreign minister suggested that Moscow could dispatch a military deployment to Venezuela and Cuba, as the Kremlin seeks to pressure Washington to respond to its demands to halt Western military activity that it says threatens Russia. And one thing I just want to point out, Akim, when you hear about things like this, like a foreign minister said this, or somebody, you know, from Russia made this statement, you got to understand, these people at that high level of military and government, they don't just say things off the cuff, right? Just because they feel like it, because they want to scare somebody. No, there's been talks, there's been agreements, and there's been things told to this foreign minister to say exactly what needs to be said to the press. So that way the Americans and the American politicians hear it, right? Everything is calculated in the way that it's being done, not only at the level of these politicians, but in the level of the heavens, right? The Lord, like I just read, has put an evil thought into these devil's minds, right? And this is why I bet you they've already had plans written up on the invasion of America, right? Let's continue. Quoted by the Wall Street Journal, Russia's deputy foreign minister Sergei Rybakov said that Moscow couldn't exclude dispatching military infrastructure to Venezuela or Cuba if tensions with Washington, which have escalated in recent weeks over the huge buildup of Russian troops on Ukraine borders, prompting some to suggest that the odds of a war in Europe are now the highest in decades, continue to rise, right? And it says, and remember, that's the Poland foreign minister who said that, right? It says, I don't want to confirm anything. I will not rule out anything. Depends on the actions of our American colleagues, Rybakov told privately owned Russian language television networks, RTVI, in an interview Thursday in Moscow. Vladimir Putin has repeatedly spoken out, including on the topics about what could be the measures taken by the Russian Navy if things go completely in the direction of provoking Russia and further increasing military pressure on us, Robokov said, adding that Russia didn't want to see that outcome, but the diplomats must come to an agreement. Last month, Robokov also told reporters that he couldn't exclude the possibility that relations between Russia and the U.S. could end up in a situation similar to the Cuban Missile Crisis of 1962. Just like I said, Akin, you see, so what has been will be again, right? The Lord is setting his chess pieces up, man. He is moving all the hearts of the kings of around the world around, so that way he's getting them into the spirit of war, right? And ultimately what's gonna happen is you're gonna see a buildup, right? You're gonna see more US military basically go into the Gulf of Arabia, right there where Saudi Arabia is at, right? That's another prophecy, right? That says that the Lord would take the Northern Army away from America. Now, if that's gonna happen after the invasion that's prophesized to happen, you know, who knows? But the point being is that, see, all these things are coming together. You see, this is why this has been rightly called the year of turning up, right? Because the Lord is turning the pressure up on these kings of the earth and upon the earth, right? And he's putting all his chess pieces into place, which, like I said, ultimately all this is going to amount to troops around the world all starting to build up there in the Middle East, right? And eventually come together there in the Valley of Jehoshaphat, which is going to be the valley of Armageddon, where the World War III will, you know, for the most part, culminate around, and where the Lord will meet the armies of the world and destroy them in an instant. It is Isaiah 33:1. Woe to thee that spoilest, and thou wast not spoiled, and dealest treacherously, and they dealt not treacherously with thee. When thou shalt cease to spoil, thou shalt be spoiled. And when thou shalt make an end to deal treacherously, they shall deal treacherously with thee. And this is ultimately talking about the American Empire, the nation of Edom, right? Because in Edom's climb to power and world domination, they had dealt very treacherously with the entire world. Namely, first and foremost, with the Israelites, the Negroes, Latinos, and Native Americans, right? Though Edom dealt with us separately, right, through different nations that Edom has been part of and controlled, right, and conquered us at separate times, he still did it to the Israelites, right? And the thing is all that which was sown shall now be reaped. And the Lord is doing it by having the adversaries and even some of the allies of America now starting to work a treacherous work, which will ultimately spoil America. This is Luke 12:49. I am come to send fire on the earth, and what will I if it be already kindled? You see, the Lord, he is, when he comes back, he's going to bring a lot of destruction with him, right? It tells us there in the Lord's Prayer that the Lord, you know, when his kingdom comes, his will be done, right? And for the Lord's kingdom to come, the kingdoms of this world must fall. And to do that, there's going to be a lot of destruction. But like it tells you in the scripture, that before the Lord comes and brings his destruction, that he's going to kindle the world, right? That it shall be already on fire already, right? And what's that kindling going to be? Well, it's going to be the spiritual fire that is placed upon America, right? The riots, the sedition, right? The prophet and us prophets out there preaching this truth, telling the world what is coming, telling America what it's in store for, man. You know, like I made a comment yesterday in a reply. Somebody had asked, what's the point of telling the Edomites that they're going to be destroyed, but they're still in power? Well, and I told them, well, it's all about declaring it before it actually happens. You see, because the Lord, he destroys in righteousness. And in doing so, he has to tell you of what he's going to do before he does it. That way he has given you a chance to repent. But we all know that these devils aren't going to repent. They're going to continue to do wickedly. And that's ultimately why the Lord, when he comes back and the world has been thrusted into, you know, fire for the most part, because, you know, it's going to be upheavals, sedition, riots. The economies are going to collapse. The world is going to be in a devastated state. The Lord is going to be righteous in destroying the devils who have put the world into such a wicked state and have oppressed his people for a very long time. So I just wanted to cover these points, Akim. I wanted to, you know, read some latest news to show you, man, that we are, you know, coming close to World War III, right? So with all that, I want to give all praises to Yahweh, Bashem Yahushai, Bashem Rukhok Radash, double honors my teachers, the apostles and elders, the great millstone. Peace and mercy to the elect. Shalom.